Greetings in the name of the crucified and risen Christ on this highest of holy days when we proclaim Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. We are gathered this time, as you can tell, in the sanctuary, and behind me are empty chairs. The choir is not there. So, as some people said, yes, like that first Easter with the empty tomb, here we are in an empty sanctuary. Although that empty tomb led to joy, this empty sanctuary is just strange. I'm not a big fan of it, but it is what it is, as they say. And you may have noticed or not that I'm wearing a stole that I've never worn before. This is a gift from Rick King from one of his mission trips to Ghana. And I can never resist saying a pun when I hear the nation of Ghana spoken. And so it's a reminder that we're gonna celebrate today, even though we are not together and we are under this pall of death, if you will, during this pandemic. So let us begin to prepare our hearts to receive the word of God for the people of God, a word of good news in the midst of this bad news. I'm just going to read a few verses from 1 Corinthians 15, the resurrection of Christ, and then actually just a part of one of our affirmations we have in the back of the hymnal to kind of fill this out. Paul writes to the church in Corinth, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel that I preached to you, the good news which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the word that I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain." That is the word of God for the people of God. And then continue from portions of Colossians 1:15 and following. Christ died for our sins. This is what Paul passes on as of first importance. Christ died for our sins. He was buried. He was raised on the third day. And he appeared first to the women, and then to Peter and the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the firstborn of all creation, the firstborn from the dead, in whom all things hold together, in whom the fullness of God was pleased to dwell by the power of the Spirit. Christ is the head of the body of the church, and by the blood of the cross reconciles all things to God. Amen. So the most ancient Christian burial liturgy comes from the 9th century. And it begins with these words that I have spoken often at the graveside. In the midst of life, we are in death. From whom can we seek help? People in the 9th century were familiar with death, acquainted with death in a way that we in the 21st century are not. But in this global pandemic, where the death toll is rising, where job losses are mounting, where looked forward to events are disappearing from the calendar, there is a pall of death over the land, over the nations, like no other time in recent history. A strange logic prevails right now. Loving our neighbor as ourself means keeping distance from one another. So much so that, again, I am preaching to an empty sanctuary this morning. It is a strange logic, but it is our present reality, and I'm having trouble adjusting to it a little bit. There is in me a stubborn resistance, a defiance. I was tempted, as I said in my newsletter, to defy the ban on gathering and saying, why don't we just gather together for at least Easter Sunday? Because again, part of what it means to gather is to sing together as we praise and celebrate God. And I am one who enjoys singing. And particularly on Easter Sunday, that great Wesleyan hymn, Christ the Lord is risen today, alleluia. I've been singing that around the house. In fact, my youngest son was singing it at the top of his lungs last night, even on Good Friday, as we look forward to Easter Sunday. It is a hymn that is meant to be sung in community, and there's something deeply powerful when it is sung together, that sense of triumph over the grave, and I greatly miss that, and I greatly miss seeing you out there gathered in the name of Christ. But here we are. We are clinging to this death-defying truth. We are going to raise our joys and triumphs high. In the midst of life, we are in death. From whom can we seek help? Perhaps YouTube. You know, I heard recently that a man by the name of John Krasinski, who plays Jim on the sitcom The Office, which is no longer running, but running in reruns on the Comedy Channel, John Krasinski has put on YouTube a little show called, excuse me, Some Good News, because we are desperate for good news because we're in the midst of so much continuing bad news. So Some Good News. I saw that the first episode on YouTube had like 15 million viewers. Incredible. We are hungry for good news. Some good news is good, but the good news is better. And so Paul reminds us that we are to remain anchored in the good news. So very, very simply this morning, keeping it simple from that 1 Corinthians 15, you know, where he says, this is the good news that we have received and on which we stand and by which we are being saved. And we receive this news about Jesus, about who he is, as the one who wept with Martha and Mary at the tomb of Lazarus, as the one who washed the disciples' feet, as the one who continues to go with us all the way to the cross and beyond. That we receive this not as something that we have made up, not as a cleverly invented myth, not as something we can intuit or we can reach through inductive reasoning, but rather, as Paul says, it is a mystery that has been hidden for ages and generations, but has now been disclosed to the saints. We receive this as a gift. We did not make it up. We could not make it up. It is news that is a gift about who God is and what he has done in Jesus Christ. And we celebrate that. And more than celebrate, we stand on it. On Christ, the solid rock we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. So there's something secure and essential about this truth that we celebrate this morning. We have received it, and it is deeply and profoundly and always true. And we celebrate that as well. And in that truth, we are being saved, right? Which is not only a future security, an inheritance that will never perish, spoil, or fade, but is also a present power. We have access to that power, that salvation power, that resurrection power here and now. As Paul says, may we be strengthened by this power in our inner being. As he continues to pray, may you have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the measure of all the fullness of God. So we have received this good news. We stand on this solid ground, and we are being renewed day by day. Even though outwardly we might be wasting away, inwardly we are being renewed day by day. You know, I saw an article earlier last week, it said cemeteries attract more visitors during coronavirus restrictions. Interesting. I don't know about you, if you ever take a walk in a cemetery or you think that is a morbid activity. But just recently, I took a walk in the Northeast Cemetery. I personally like walking in cemeteries. Often our parsonages have been located within walking distance of one. They are quiet and serene, often spacious with beautiful monuments. They're nice places to take a walk. Also, when you're in a cemetery, it's humbling. It's humbling to be in a cemetery. Somebody said, it is there where we confront our mortality, where we are stripped bare of all of our pretenses. It reveals who we really are, which is a vulnerable creature of the dust, right? The grass withers and the flower fades. And so walking in the Northeast Cemetery, I was struck by this black granite tombstone with the name of Kimberly Dawn Hare on it. A young lady who was born in 74, but died in 1993. And laser etched in that was a stunning testimony. Some of you know about this tombstone. It is really amazing to read her whole testimony from a journal written all over her tombstone. It begins by saying, "My name is Kimberly Hare, and I would like to share my feelings with you." And as you read it, you feel like she is there and sharing this testimony with you. She was diagnosed with cancer, with leukemia at the age of 14. And initially she shares her struggles and her doubts. She says rather boldly, you know, "If there is a God, how dare you do this to me? I'm not such a bad person. What did I do to deserve this?" Cancer diagnosis at the age of 14. She says she spent over 4 years in remission, attending church reluctantly, infrequently, not getting much out of it. And then she relapsed in October of 1992. And she said, "All I could think about was dying, that I would just be dead and not with God. I would be put in the ground and I would be forgotten." But a pastor that she knew, she said, never gave up on her, continued to tell her about Jesus and, yes, the resurrection. And she said, "Something finally changed inside of me. A light was lit inside of me. It was Jesus in my heart. Now, he had always been there, but I was too angry and afraid to accept him." Too angry and afraid. And then she goes on to share in this testimonial on her tombstone, "I am now not afraid of dying. Cancer can take my body, but it will not take my faith. I am a very happy person," she says. "I love life and I want to share it. Thank you for bringing the Lord into my life." Now it says that was a journal entry from August of 93. A mere 4 months later in December, she would die. It's a remarkable thing to see a testimony like this etched on a tombstone. If you ever have the time to walk, and who of us doesn't have a little more time, the Northeast Cemetery, look for it. What a testimony of death-defying truth, empowering us now, in the present even, to live in a way that we don't allow anger and fear to get the best of our hearts. "The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever," says Isaiah. And Paul says, just as we have borne the likeness of the earthly man, Adam, so shall we bear the likeness of the man from heaven, which is Jesus. That is part of the good news that we have received and in which we stand and by which we are saved. In the midst of life, we are in death. From whom can we seek our help? Matthew in his gospel says, "The women hurried from the tomb and they were afraid and yet filled with joy. And they ran and they told the disciples." Someone said the first Easter with its joyful surprise emerged out of suffering and fear and suspicion and death and sorrow and grief. Easter in the time of coronavirus, there I said it, is closer to us experientially than that first Easter. In other words, this Easter is different. In the past, we often celebrate Easter with a kind of self-indulgence and triumphalism. But here we actually do feel a pall of death upon the land. And yet we get to have that joyful surprise of Easter. In the midst of life, we are in death. From whom can we seek help? And then the words come, our help is in the name of the Lord, the creator of heaven and earth. God, who raised Christ from the dead, will give life to our mortal bodies also through the Spirit that dwells in each of us by faith. As the closing hymn often said, that we sing often on Easter says, death cannot keep its prey, for he tore the bars away. Up from the grave he arose, right? With a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with the saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. May we continue to receive this good news as a gift. May we stand on this good news as an eternal truth. May we sense that we are being renewed day by day, being saved by this good news, receiving, standing, being saved. Indeed, let us stand firm. Let us allow nothing to move us from this glorious truth. Resolve to give ourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that our labor in the Lord, our life in Christ, is not in vain. May it be so for you and for me. Let us pray. God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, this Easter is like no other Easter I have experienced. God, help us to be with those who especially feel the pall of death, or at least the pall of disappointment or discouragement or despair in these difficult times. Help us to live, God, with conviction about the gospel, with the courage of the gospel, with the compassion of this good news. This we pray in the crucified and risen name of Jesus Christ. And now may the hope of Christ and the gospel live in you always. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And stay tuned perhaps for a closing hymn. God bless and take care.